Wow. What else can you say about that fight? Stipe Miocic versus Francis Ngannou 2 is in the books, and Francis won by second round KO. A pretty brutal KO, if I'm being honest. Going into this fight, there were a lot of questions. In the first fight, obviously, Stipe dominated Francis. You know, 50-45, basically. Outstruck him, took him down, dominated him on the ground, and Francis really looked clueless, like he didn't know what he was doing. In his next fight after that with Derek Lewis, he was completely hesitant and gun-shy. He talked about that, how the fight with Stipe had damaged his self-confidence. He had to build himself back up, and he put together four fights, four wins, against Curtis Blaydes, Cain Velasquez, Junior Dos Santos, and Jairzinho Rozenstruik. You know, all together, a total fight time of, like, 2 minutes. And meanwhile, Stipe had been fighting Daniel Cormier, lost the first one, obviously, and then won the second and third fights, both of which he took a lot of damage in. And going into this fight, there was this mystery. Because in Francis's four wins after losing to Stipe and to Derek Lewis, he didn't show us anything, really. There was zero evidence that he had improved to the point that he could counter what Stipe was going to bring to the table. You know, logically, Stipe seemed like he would have the tools necessary to beat Francis again. We didn't see Francis ever get challenged in terms of wrestling. And frankly, if you look at some of the fights, like the Rozenstruik fight, it's 18 seconds, 20 seconds, and Francis is just throwing wild haymakers. You know, there was zero reason to think he could beat Stipe, other than the idea that Stipe may have been diminished after the back-to-back wars with Cormier, and the vague possibility that Francis had improved after the Stipe fight. You know, bolstered by some things his coaches were saying, that he had been training wrestling and grappling extensively in preparation for the Stipe fight, but we hadn't seen any evidence of that. As the fight week drew nearer, I had a few people ask me who I thought was going to win, and like most people, I thought Stipe logically would be the one to win because we just don't have any evidence that Ngannou would be able to beat him. But I also thought all it really is going to take for Francis to beat Stipe is for him to be patient and pick his shots. And that's what happened. You know, this was an incredible performance by Francis Ngannou. He came out so composed, so patient. He took the center of the octagon from the opening seconds of the fight. He never chased Stipe. He was not throwing wild punches. He was throwing mostly straight punches. He was throwing a lot of leg kicks, which I thought were really interesting. He threw a head kick that really seemed to hurt Stipe in the first round. But otherwise, he was very composed and not throwing those wild looping, swinging, sweeping hooks and like shovel uppercuts he likes to throw. Everything was on point. And early in the fight, we got an answer to that question of how would Francis handle the wrestling of Stipe in the rematch? And the answer was he handled it perfectly fine. In fact, he stuffed Stipe, he sprawled, then he spun around and took Stipe's back. Then he got a takedown of his own. Who in their prediction of the fights was thinking that Ngannou would be the one to get the takedown? And when he got that takedown, he was landing some hellacious shots. I mean, for a moment while I was watching the fight, I literally thought we were going to see, like, a redo of Anthony Rumble Johnson versus Alexander Gustafsson. Now, Stipe did get to his feet, so he wasn't being completely demolished on the ground. And then Francis did something that was so smart, because he almost went for another takedown, but then he realized that it was a bad idea to, you know, waste energy on the takedown, so he just let Stipe get back to his feet. They separated, and they went back to striking. And you saw more of those like leg kicks from Francis and more of those nice clean punches to end round one. In round two, again, more of the same. Francis just looked so composed. And that was the big question coming into this fight. We saw how wild he had looked in some of his other fights, just winging punches with almost no form. Nothing resembling like boxing form. But in this fight, again, very composed, laser focused. And he catches Stipe with this, like, step-in kind of, almost something between, like, a jab and a hook, I think. It wasn't quite really a straight jab, and it wasn't really a hook, but it kind of came in between Stipe's gloves and just knocked him off his feet. He lands up against the cage. They exchange a little bit. Stipe actually catches Francis with this little, like, check left hook. I think both of his feet were off the ground, basically, and it stunned Francis. But this is the scary thing about Ngannou. Not only is he maybe the hardest puncher in the history of MMA, he has an absolutely rock-solid chin. He's eaten some of the hardest shots from Stipe we've ever seen and barely been fazed. And when Stipe landed that shot, you know, his feet were planted and he just got caught by Francis, dropped, and then Francis hit him with the fucking flying fist of doom. It reminds me of Hendo versus Bisping, which I believe Sean Baby called Fistos, the Forbidden Punch of Legend. An absolute classic. And Francis wins. He is the new heavyweight champion of the UFC. And what a story. Of course I'm sad for Stipe. He's one of my favorite fighters. He's UFC heavyweight GOAT. Maybe the greatest heavyweight of all time. But he's getting old. He's 38 and you just can't take punches from a guy like Ngannou. Especially after you've had your chin cracked a few times and you've been through wars. I'm sure they're going to have a third fight, unless Stipe calls it or something, but for the time being, Francis is the champ, and it's nothing short of a underdog story. I get that he was a favorite from a betting odds perspective, but if you look at his life, growing up in poverty in Cameroon, literally having to work in a sand mine to pay to go to school, being stuck in this hopeless quagmire, nobody believes this dream that he has to become a boxer. And so he has to find another place where he has the opportunity. He spends, you know, 14 months, I think it was, essentially trying to get into Europe, getting picked up by the government in Morocco. They dump him in the Sahara Desert. He has to make it back. He does this half a dozen times, finally gets to Spain, gets to Paris. He's homeless. He starts training. He goes on this incredible run. He loses to Stipe. He feels that crushing defeat. He climbs back to the top, and now he is a champion. And with Francis winning, immediately we have these conversations about Francis versus John Jones. Because right after the fight, John Jones tweets out whatever, like something like, let's play, baby, and then show me the money and all this stuff. Personally, I think that is John's way of like leaving the door open so that he can back out of this fight, as he did before with the UFC, their disagreements in how much he was getting paid. Now, of course, I think that John should be paid more than he is being paid, but I also think he is going to ask for more money than he knows the UFC will pay him, so he's going to basically price himself out of the market so that he can say, they want me to go up and wait and fight Francis, and I want to be paid this much. They're not going to pay me that, so I'm going to go back down to heavyweight. I could be wrong. I also don't think Jones has much for Francis Ngannou. I mean, could he beat him? Maybe. On paper, I think Francis is a stylistic nightmare. John was struggling to take down middleweights and, you know, JV baseball players. I think he lost to Reyes. He still technically won the fights on the scorecards, but I think he looks diminished as compared to what he was in the past. His offense is greatly reduced. I don't really know what he would bring to the table against Francis. The only real argument I've heard in favor of him is, you know, he's the GOAT, therefore he's going to be much better than Francis. Or that because he's bulked up, he's going to be much stronger, and he's going to be able to take Francis down really easily. I don't really think so, at least not with this version of Francis. If his takedown defense holds up, and with this sort of new composed style of striking that he can bring to the cage, or honestly just wild striking, against John Jones, who is this, in the terms of stand-up, a very much a point fighter who likes to keep range and sort of pepper guys with strikes and use a lot of those oblique kicks, the front kicks, the side kicks, a jab. Francis just bum-rushing him like he did Rosenstreich might be the right idea. What is John going to do in that situation if Francis just charges at him throwing a 12-punch combination? I think he's going to get knocked out. And I think if he tries to wrestle Ngannou, it's not... I mean, think back to the fight with Alistair Overeem. Alistair tied up with Francis and immediately got turned into the fence. Just immediately got overpowered. And Overeem is not just a strong guy, but a very good grappler. So if Overeem is getting overpowered that easily in the clinch, I have doubts about how John will do. And there's also this new element of the leg kicks. If I was going to pick one specific technique that I think would work really effectively against John, I'd say it would be leg kicks. Because the way he fights, he often leaves his legs exposed, And I think also, if you look at John, his legs are probably like one of the weaker parts of his body. This is going to sound like a conspiracy theory or something crazy to people, but throughout his career, he's historically had medical issues with his legs and his feet. For instance, in the Thiago Santos fight, John had to be wheeled out of the arena in a wheelchair. And that's not like the first time he's been carried out or walked out on crutches or been taken to the hospital or broken his foot after a fight that he won. So that's my personal opinion. I think leg kicks could be an incredibly effective tool against John. But we're still at the point where we have no idea what will happen with John Jones versus Francis Ngannou, whether John will actually commit to fighting at heavyweight or if this has just all been, you know, a way to let the light heavyweight division kind of clean itself up so that John can come back down. At the moment, we just don't know. We'll have to wait and see how this all plays out. Of course, Stipe versus Ngannou wasn't the only fight on the card. Co-main event was Tyron Woodley versus Vicente Luque. A sort of sad fight, honestly. Going into this fight, you know, I think the real story was this Tyron Woodley's last hurrah? He suffered 3 losses in a row going into this fight. Obviously, the Kamaru Usman fight, then the loss to Gilbert Burns, and then the loss to Colby Covington, losing 14 rounds in a row and then being finished by Covington in the 5th round of their fight. And he's going up against this brawler in Luque, pressure fighter. Historically, Woodley has struggled against pressure fighters. Putting his back up against the fence is a tried and true way of beating Tyron Woodley. So I think there was a general consensus that Luque was going to put Tyron Woodley out to pasture, so to speak. And initially, Woodley surprised me. He came out guns blazing. He rushed right in, threw a punch, grabbed a body lock, I think, pushed Luque right to the fence, and that's kind of where it fell apart. Luque turned Woodley around, and we had like 2 minutes of clinching along the fence. Eventually, they broke apart, which is where it got really bad for Woodley. Credit to him, he was throwing heat. He was swinging for the bleachers, you know, and he hurt Luque pretty badly, but Luque landed this counter right that stunned Tyron, and he just couldn't get back into the fight from there. I think personally he was out on his feet because he like stumbled across the cage, and then he was like in a shootout with Luque and they were swinging back and forth, and you know, he got caught again, but he just seemed completely out of it. And when he got dropped again, to me it almost seemed like Luque just didn't want to hit Tyron anymore. Like I got that feeling that he just felt kind of bad. So instead of just pummeling Woodley, he dropped down for Darce choke and submitted him. It's 4 straight losses in a row for Woodley at this point. I respect him for going out in a shield basically at the end of that round. He wasn't going to win it doing what he normally does, which is backing up and waiting for a counterpunch. At the end of the day, that doesn't really matter. He still has lost 4 fights in a row. I feel like he's had one of the most like precipitous declines in MMA history. He went from being possibly a candidate for welterweight GOAT, like behind like Matt Hughes. I mean, he wasn't going to overcome GSP, but he was up in that general area of maybe top two or three greatest welterweights of all time. And then he gets demolished by Usman. He gets demolished by Gilbert Burns. He gets demolished by Colby Covington. And now he got demolished by Vicente Luque. He doesn't look good out there. I think he's declined athletically. I don't think his body is doing what he wants it to do. His chin, he didn't get knocked out, but I don't think his chin is really where it should be anymore. I don't think he can take shots the way he used to. And I don't think he can get the fight to the ground the way he used to be able to, which was kind of the way he began his career. A lot of people forget this, but Woodley was initially known years ago as being like a lay and pray kind of guy before he discovered that he had like crazy power in his hands. He got some vicious knockouts, and then he became this like a very patient, forbearing counterpuncher, which worked out for him for a while, but in his last 4 fights, it kind of became his downfall. At this point, I think it's time for Woodley to retire. If he wants to go down to Bellator or some other organization, maybe he can win some fights there, but I don't really even think that's a possibility. He really just doesn't seem like he has it in him anymore to fight. There's just like something missing. It's hard to explain. He doesn't look like the same fighter he looked like, you know, 4 years ago, 5 years ago. And that's sad. I mean, hopefully he does decide to hang them up and call it a career, because his career is nothing to be ashamed of. It's one of the best careers in welterweight history if you look at the highs, if you look at the things he's been able to accomplish, if you look at the title fight victories he's put together, and especially at like the age he did it. But I think I've rambled on enough about Tyron Woodley at this point. Let's talk about Thomas Almeida versus Sugar Sean O'Malley. I'll be honest, I do not like Sean O'Malley. To me, he seems like a douche. He seems like an egomaniac, even though he's really not done anything impressive in the UFC. Coming into this fight, his biggest win was Eddie Wineland. And Eddie Wineland, like, way past his prime. He lost to Chito Vera, and Sean did not accept the defeat. He has made excuses and excuses. He also just seems like a shitty person to me, like with the shit he said about Megan Anderson. So I don't like Sean O'Malley, and I actively root for his downfall in the sport. Against Thomas Almeida, though, the odds of Sean O'Malley losing were kind of slim. Going into this fight, Almeida was on a 3-fight losing streak and had lost 4 in his last 5. I personally think he has not looked the same since he got smashed by Cody Garbrandt. He really brought nothing to the table. Aside from a couple of little slapping outside leg kicks, he was constantly stuck at range against O'Malley, which is, you know, O'Malley deserves credit for doing that, but also at the same time, Almeida just wasn't doing anything to get in. He wasn't using any feints. He wasn't using really any footwork. He wasn't using head movement. He was just kind of trying to like wade in with his hands up high, getting hit with jabs, getting hit with little side kicks, getting hit with the occasional teep to the midsection. And then, you know, O'Malley lands a big kick that knocks Almeida down. And there's this weird moment where Almeida's like against the cage and O'Malley seems like he doesn't know what to do, like almost like he expects it to be a walk-off KO. And Almeida's laying there like looking at the referee almost like expecting he's going to fight it, but the referee doesn't step in. Almeida gets back to his feet and he finishes the round. But that was kind of the story of the fight for 2.5-ish rounds. O'Malley basically did what he wanted. He was kind of playing with Almeida a lot. He was switching stances, throwing some like unconventional shots, doing like little bolo punch maneuver. This weird like feint he does with his head, where he like twists his head real quick, which I don't think Almeida bit on a single time, but O'Malley just kept doing it. It kind of makes him look like an idiot, but that's just my personal opinion. And then late in the third, there was like a clinch situation, I think, and O'Malley lands a punch. I think it was an uppercut. I'd have to go back and watch it. I don't really remember off the top of my head, but I believe it was like a little uppercut in the clinch or a hook. And Almeida kind of tumbles over and is laying like half propped up. And it looks like the ref should step in because Almeida just doesn't. He's like not. He's lackadaisical. He's not really making an effort to move or defend himself. And Sean walks over and just clocks him. I think he knocked him out like cold, but I could be wrong. Either way, Almeida was just laying there, flat on his back, not moving. And it was sort of a iffy situation of should that fight have been stopped or not, because I don't think Almeida had any desire to get up and continue. Aside from some vague questions about the stoppage, where does O'Malley go from here with this win? Almeida's probably getting cut because this will be 4 straight losses in a row, but the next step forward's a bit more ambiguous for O'Malley. This wasn't like a big win. This was like as close to a gimme fight or, you know, a softball fight or like a warm-up fight to get back in there and get O'Malley's shit together. Who does he fight next? Like, there's this aura and mystique kind of building up around him, but if you actually look at who he's fought so far in the UFC, it's not particularly impressive. Like I said, Eddie Wineland is maybe the best win on his record. He just beat Almeida, who I think is frankly shot. But if you look at his record and you look at the guys he's fought in the UFC specifically, if you tally up their collective win-to-loss ratio in the UFC, his opponents have a record of 19-27. If you take O'Malley out of the equation, if you remove those losses, it's still 19-22. So either way, we're looking at fighters who have worse than a 0.500 ratio, or worse than 50-50. I feel like O'Malley is basically the UFC's answer to MVP Michael Venom Page for Bellator. I imagine they're going to continue to put him up against guys with losing records or at best 50-50 records until they can take their opportunity and put him up against maybe somebody of substance and hope he can beat them. but for the time being, it just seems like he's going to be crushing some cans. Honorable mentions for this card. I liked Miranda Maverick versus Jillian Robertson. I thought that was a very entertaining back and forth fight. Maverick had some good action in the first. Robertson took the second round and really showed some strong grappling. But then in the third, I think Maverick realized she might be down two rounds, and she really went hard in the grappling and was able to, I think, dominate Jillian in a lot of positions. It also had the most significant moments of the fight with some decent shots on the ground. It really seemed like she adjusted well and learned from what she dealt with in the second round. And I think she could be a pretty interesting prospect in the women's 125-pound division. Also, Abubakar Nurmagomedov versus Jared Gooden was an interesting fight. We expect a guy with that kind of surname to come in and just be a powerhouse wrestler. And he did have success in the grappling, but I really like what he was able to do on the feet. I think he has a very nice jab, a good left hook, a good straight, and he used them really well in combination. He had really fast hands, too. That was something that really was impressive, how quick he was. The way he throws his jab is going to sound kind of funny, but it's very reminiscent of what Michael Jai White tried to teach Kimbo Slice, where you don't throw with the shoulder at all. He has this very sneaky little jab that doesn't give you like any kind of tell with it. He just pops it out real quick, and he kept catching Gooden with that shot repeatedly during the fight. He is obviously a guy to watch alongside pretty much anyone from Dagestan. They're all going to be fucking problems for anyone matched up against them. That's about all I have to say about this event. I know this is kind of a different thing. It was just a spur-of-the-moment idea. You know, I talk a lot of shit about MMA on Twitter especially, but it is something that's on my mind all the time, and I'm debating if I want to do occasional MMA discussions, like just sort of topical stuff. It doesn't necessarily fit in with the theme of the channel, so I may end up making like a second channel where I post this kind of content over there, but I want your opinion. This was kind of all off the cuff. So I would like your opinion if you find this interesting, or if you don't like it, if you don't think it fits the channel. This is just an experiment, so obviously I appreciate any feedback you can give me. As always, I want to thank you for watching the video, as well as liking, commenting, and subscribing. And I would like to give a special thank you to my supporters on Patreon who help make these videos possible. Thank you. Bone CK, Dan Thomas, Dirtbag Thor, Erica Hughes, Fightback CBD, James Taylor, Mike Robals, Ryan Sedor, Zelda Z, Kevin Howard, Kyle, Max, Neem, Raghav Verma, Tambi Helmick, and the Son of Man.